चैप्टर वन योगा एस एक्शन द सिक्स्थ एंड एइथ चैप्टर ऑफ भगवद गीता लॉर्ड श्री कृष्णा द सुप्रीम पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ गॉड हेड एक्सप्लेन्स दैट द एइथ फोल्ड योगा सिस्टम इज अ मीन्स टू कंट्रोल द माइंड एंड सेंसेस दिस मेथड हाउएवर इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर पीपल टू परफॉर्म especially in this age of Kali, an age characterized by ignorance and chaos. Although this eightfold yoga system is particularly recommended in the sixth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the Lord emphasizes that the process of Karma Yoga, action in Krishna consciousness, is superior. In this world, everyone acts to maintain his family and everyone is working with a view to some self-interest or personal sense gratification, be it concentrated or extended. But to act perfectly is to act in Krishna consciousness, and this means acting detached from the fruits of labor. It is our duty to act in Krishna consciousness because we are constitutionally parts and parcel of the Supreme. The parts of the body work for the satisfaction of the entire body, not for the individual parts. The goal is the satisfaction of the complete whole. Similarly, the living entity should act for the satisfaction of the supreme whole, the supreme personality of Godhead, and not for his own personal satisfaction. One who can do this is a perfect sannyasi and the perfect yogi. In the first verse of the sixth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the chapter dealing with Sankhya Yoga, Bhagavan Shri Krishna states, Anashritya karma phalam karyam karma karoti yaha sasanyasi cha yogi cha naniragnir na chakriyaha. One who is unattached to the fruits of his work and who works as he is obligated is in the renounced order of life and he is a true mystic. Not he who lights no fire and performs no work. Sometimes sannyasis, renunciates, incorrectly think that they have become liberated from all material engagements and therefore no longer have to perform Agnihotra yajnas or fire sacrifices. This is a mistake. Certain yajna sacrifices have to be performed by everyone for purification. Since sannyasis are not traditionally required to perform yajnas, they sometimes think that they can attain liberation by ceasing to perform the ritualistic yajnas. But actually, unless one comes to the platform of Krishna consciousness, there is no question of liberation. Those sannyasis who cease to perform yajnas are in fact acting out of self-interest, because their goal is to become one with the impersonal Brahman. That is the ultimate goal of the impersonalist, Mayavadis, who have one major goal or demand, to become one with the supreme impersonal being. The devotees have no such demands. They are simply satisfied in serving Krishna for the satisfaction of Krishna. They do not want anything in return. That is a characteristic of pure devotion. It was Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who expressed this devotional attitude so succinctly. न धनम न जनम न सुंदरीम कविताम वा जगदीश कामये मम जन्मनि जन्मनीश्वरे भवताद् भक्ति रहेतु की त्वयि चैतन्य चरितामृत अंत्य लीला चैप्टर 20 वर्स 29 एंड शिक्षाष्टकम वर्स 4 ओ ऑलमाइटी लॉर्ड आई हैव नो डिजायर टू अक्युमुलेट वेल्थ नॉर टू एंजॉय ब्यूटिफुल विमेन नॉर डू आई वॉन्ट एनी नंबर ऑफ फॉलोअर्स. What I want is only the causeless mercy of your devotional service in my life, birth after birth. In essence, this is a Bhakti Yoga system. There are many examples of pure devotional attitude. Once Lord Narsingadev told Prahlad Maharaj, "My dear boy, you have suffered so much for me. Whatever you want, ask for it." Being a pure devotee, Prahlad Maharaj refused to ask for anything. He said, "My dear master, I am not carrying out mercantile business with you. I will not accept any remuneration for my service." This is a pure devotional attitude. Yogis and Jnanis are demanding to become one with the Supreme because they have such bitter experience suffering the material pangs. They want to become one with the Lord because they are suffering in separation. A pure devotee, however, does not experience this. Although separate from the Lord, he fully enjoys the service of the Lord in separation. The desire to become one with the impersonal Brahman or to merge with God is certainly greater than any material desire, but this is not without self-interest. Similarly, the mystic yogi who practices the yoga system with half-open eyes, ceasing all material activities, desires some satisfaction for his personal self. Such yogis are desirous of material power, and that is their conception of perfection of yoga. Actually, this is not the perfection of yoga, but a materialistic process. If one practices the regulative principles of yoga, he can attain 8 kinds of perfection. He can become lighter than a cotton swab. He can become heavier than a great stone. He can immediately get whatever he likes. Sometimes he can even create a planet. Although rare, such powerful yogis actually exist. Vishwamitra Yogi wanted to beget a man from a palm tree. He was thinking, why should a man have to live so many months within the womb of his mother? Why can't he be produced just like a fruit? Thinking like this, Vishwamitra Yogi produced men like coconuts. Sometimes yogis are so powerful, they can perform such acts, but these are all material powers. Ultimately, such yogis are vanquished because they cannot retain these material powers indefinitely. Bhakti yogis are not interested in such powers. The bhakti yogi, acting in Krishna consciousness, works for the satisfaction of the whole without self-interest. A Krishna conscious person does not desire self-satisfaction. Rather, his criterion of success is the satisfaction of Krishna. Therefore, he is considered the perfect sannyasi and the perfect yogi. A pure devotee does not even want salvation. The salvationists want to be saved from rebirth, and the voidists also want to put an end to all material life. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, however, requested only devotional service to Lord Krishna, birth after birth. In other words, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was prepared to endure material miseries in one body after another. What then was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's desire? He wanted to engage in God's service and nothing more, for that is the real perfection of yoga. Whether in the spiritual sky or the material sky, the individual spirit soul is constitutionally the same. It is said that he is 1/10,000th part of the tip of a hair. This means that our position is that of a small particle, but spirit can expand. Just as we develop a material body in the material world, we develop a spiritual body in the spiritual world. In the material world, expansion takes place in contact with matter. In the spiritual world, this expansion is spiritual. Actually, the first lesson of Bhagavad Gita is, I am spirit soul. I am different from this body. I am a living force. But this material body is not a living force. It is dull matter, and it is activated only because spiritual force is present. In the spiritual world, everything is living force. There is no dead matter. There, the body is totally spiritual. One may compare the spirit soul with oil and the body with water. When oil is in water, there is a distinction, and that distinction always remains. In the spiritual sky, there is no question of oil being placed in water. There, everything is spirit. The impersonalists do not want to develop a body. They simply want to remain spiritual particles, and that is their idea of happiness. But we bhakti yogis, Vaishnavas, want to serve Krishna, and therefore we require hands, legs, and all the other bodily parts. Indeed, we are given these bodies in order to serve Krishna. Just as we develop a material body in our mother's womb, we can similarly develop a spiritual body in the spiritual world. The spiritual body is developed through the practice of Krishna consciousness. This material body is spiritualized by this bhakti yoga process. If you place an iron within the fire, the iron becomes so hot that it also becomes fiery. When the iron is red hot, it acquires all the qualities of fire. If you touch something with that iron will act as fire. Similarly, although this body is material, it can become spiritualized through Krishna consciousness and act as spirit. Although copper is just a metal, as soon as it comes in contact with electricity, it becomes electrified, and if you touch it, you will receive an electric shock. As soon as your body is spiritualized, material activity ceases. Material activity means acting for sense gratification. As you become spiritualized, material demands dwindle until they become nil. How is this possible? In order for an iron to act as fire, it must remain constantly in contact with fire. In order for the material body to become spiritualized, one must remain constantly in Krishna consciousness. When this material body is fully engaged in spiritual activity, it becomes spiritual. According to Vedic system, the body of a high personality, a sannyasi, is not burned but buried. Because a sannyasi's body is considered spiritual, having ceased to engage in material activities. If everyone in this world engages fully in Krishna consciousness and ceases to work for sense gratification, this entire world will immediately become spiritual. Therefore, it is necessary to learn how to work for the satisfaction of Krishna. This requires a little time to understand. If something is used for Krishna's satisfaction, it is spiritual. Since we are using microphones, typewriters, etc., in order to talk and write about Krishna, they became spiritualized. What is the difference between prasad and ordinary food? Some people may say, what is this prasad? We are eating the same food. Why do you call it prasad? It is prasad because it has been offered for Krishna's satisfaction and has thus become spiritualized. In a higher sense, there is no matter at all. Everything is spiritual. Because Krishna is spiritual and matter is one of the energies of Krishna, matter is also spiritual. Krishna is totally spiritual and spirit comes from spirit. However, because the living entity are misusing this energy, that is using it for something other than Krishna's purposes, it becomes materialized and so we call it matter. The purpose of this Krishna conscious movement is to re-spiritualize this energy. It is our purpose to re-spiritualize the whole world socially and politically. Of course, this may not be possible, but it is our ideal. At least if we individually take up this re-spiritualization process, our lives become perfect. In Bhagavad Gita 9 chapter 22nd verse, Krishna says that he provides for his devotees by giving them what they lack and preserving what they have. People are very fond of saying that God helps those who help themselves. But they do not understand that helping yourself means putting yourself under Krishna's protection. If one thinks, oh, I can help myself, I can protect myself, one is thinking foolishly. As long as my finger is attached to my body, it is useful. And I may spend thousands of dollars to preserve it. But if this finger is cut off, it is useless and is thrown away. Similarly, we are part and parcel of Krishna, and helping ourselves means putting ourselves in our proper position as His part and parcels. Otherwise, we are only fit to be cast away. The finger can help itself only when situated properly on the hand and working on behalf of the entire body. If the finger thinks I will separate myself from this body and simply help myself, that finger will be cast away and will die. As soon as we think I shall live independently of Krishna, that is our spiritual death. And as soon as we engage in Krishna's service as His part and parcel, that is our spiritual life. Therefore, help oneself means knowing one's actual position and working accordingly. It is not possible to help oneself without knowing one's position. Service means activity. For when we serve someone, we are acting. When we serve Krishna, we are preaching Krishna consciousness, or cooking, or cleansing the temple, or distributing books about Krishna, or writing about Him, or shopping for foodstuffs to offer Him. There are so many ways to serve. Helping Krishna means acting for Him, not sitting down in one place and artificially meditating. Krishna consciousness means activity. Whatever assets we have should be utilized for Krishna. That is the process of Bhakti Yoga. Krishna has given us a mind and we must utilize this mind to think of Krishna. We have been given these hands and we must use them to wash the temple or cook for Krishna. We have been given these legs and we should use them to go to temple of Krishna. We have been given a nose and we should use it to smell the flowers that have been offered to Krishna. Through the process of Bhakti Yoga, we engage all these senses in the service of Krishna, and in this way the senses are spiritualized. In Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna was refusing to act and Krishna was inspiring him to engage in activity. The entire Bhagavad Gita is an inspiration to work, to engage in Krishna consciousness, to act on Krishna's behalf. Krishna never tells Arjuna, "My dear friend Arjuna, don't concern yourself with this war. Just sit down and meditate upon me." This is not the message of Bhagavad Gita. We are not to refrain from all activity, but only from those activities that impede our consciousness of Krishna. Meditation means stopping all nonsensical activity. Those who are advanced in Krishna consciousness are constantly working for Krishna. A mother tells only her bad child to sit down and do nothing. If a child can do nothing but disturb his mother, the mother says, "My dear child, just sit down here and keep quiet." But if the child can work nicely, the mother says, "My dear child, will you please help me do this? Will you go over there and do that?" Sitting still in one place is just for those who do not know how to work sensibly. As long as a child sits in one place, he does not raise havoc. Sitting still means negating nonsense. It is not positive activity. In negation, there is no life. Positive activities constitute life, and positive activity is a message of Bhagavad Gita. Spiritual life is not "don't do this." Spiritual life is "do this." In order to act properly, there are certain things that one must know not to do. Therefore, certain activities are forbidden. The whole Bhagavad Gita, however, is "do." Krishna says, "Fight for me." At the beginning of Bhagavad Gita, when Arjuna told Krishna, "I will not fight," Sri Krishna said, "Kutastva kashmalam nidam vishame samupastitam anarya jushtam asvargyam akirti karam Arjuna." "My dear Arjuna, how have these impurities come upon you? They are not at all befitting a man who knows the progressive values of life. They lead not to higher planets, but to infamy." Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, 2nd verse. Krishna directly tells Arjuna that he is speaking like a non-Aryan, that is, like one who does not know the spiritual values of life. So Krishna consciousness does not mean sitting down ideally. Krishna himself does not sit down ideally. All his pastimes are filled with activity. When we go to the spiritual world, we will see that Krishna is always engaged in dancing, eating, and enjoying. He does not sit down to meditate. Is there any account of the gopis meditating? Did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sit down to meditate? No. He was always dancing and chanting Hare Krishna. The spirit soul is naturally active. How can we sit down silently and do nothing? It is not possible. Therefore, after Sri Krishna outlined the Sankhya Yoga system in the 6th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna frankly said, "Yoyam yogastvaya prokta samyena madhusudhanam etasyaham na pashyami chanchalatvat stitim stiram." O Madhusudhana, Krishna, the system of yoga which you have summarized appears impractical and unendurable to me, for the mind is restless and unsteady. Bhagavad Gita, chapter 6, 33rd verse. Although Arjuna was highly elevated and was Krishna's intimate friend, he immediately refused to take up this Sankhya Yoga. In essence, he said, "It is not possible for me." How could it have been possible? Arjuna was a warrior, a householder, and he wanted a kingdom. What time did he have for meditation? He flatly refused to practice this type of meditation yoga, saying that the mind is as difficult to control as the wind. This is a fact. It is not possible to control the mind artificially. Therefore, we must engage the mind in Krishna consciousness. Then it is controlled. If Arjuna found this process more difficult than controlling the wind, then what of us? After all, Arjuna was not an ordinary man. He was personally talking with the Supreme Lord, Shri Krishna, and he proclaimed the mind to be like a great wind. How can we control the wind? We can control the mind only by fixing it on Krishna's lotus feet. That is the perfection of meditation. No one really wants to sit down and meditate. Why should we? We are meant for positive activity, for recreation, for pleasure. In Krishna consciousness, our recreation is dancing and chanting, and when we get tired, we take prasad. Is dancing difficult? Is chanting difficult? We don't charge anything to dance in the temple. If you go to a ballroom, you have to pay to enter, but we do not charge. It is natural to enjoy music and dancing and palatable foods. These are our recreations, and this is our method of meditation. So this yoga system is not at all laborious. It is simply recreation, susukam. It is stated in the 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, 2nd verse, that this yoga is susukam, very happy. It is everlasting and it is joyfully performed. It is natural, automatic and spontaneous. It is our real life in the spiritual world. In Vaikuntha, the spiritual world, there is no anxiety. Vaikuntha means freedom from anxiety. And in Vaikuntha, the liberated souls are always dancing, chanting and taking prasad. There are no factories, hard work or technical institutions. There is no need for these artificial things. In Vedanta Sutra, it is stated, Anandamayo Abhyasat, Vedanta Sutra 1.112. God is Anandamaya, full of bliss and pleasure. Since we are part and parcel of God, we also possess these same qualities. So the goal of our yoga process is to join with the Supreme Anandamaya, Shri Krishna, to join his dance party. Then we will be actually happy. On this earth, we are trying to be happy artificially and are therefore frustrated. Once we are situated in Krishna consciousness, we will revive our original position and become simply joyful. Since our actual nature is Anandamaya, blissful, we are always searching for happiness. In the cities, we are inundated with advertisements, restaurants, bars, nightclubs and dance halls are always announcing, come on, here is Ananda, here is pleasure. That is because everyone is searching for Ananda, pleasure. Our Society for Krishna Consciousness is also announcing, here is Ananda, but our standard of pleasure is very different. In any case, the goal, pleasure, is the same. Most people are hunting for pleasure on the gross material platform. The more advanced search for pleasure in speculation, philosophy, poetry or art. The Bhakti Yogi, however, searches for pleasure on the transcendent platform, and that is his only business. Why are people working so hard? All day, they are thinking, tonight I shall enjoy. Tonight I will associate with this girl or with my wife. Thus, people are going to so much trouble to acquire little pleasure. Pleasure is the ultimate goal, but unfortunately, under illusion, people do not know where real pleasure is to be found. Real pleasure exists eternally in the transcendental form of Krishna. Perhaps you have seen pictures of Krishna, and if so, you have noticed that Krishna is always jolly. If you join his society, you will also become jolly. Have you ever seen pictures of Krishna working with a machine? Have you ever seen pictures of Krishna smoking? No, he is by nature full of pleasure. And if you unfold yourself in that way, you will also find pleasure. Pleasure cannot be found artificially. Ananda chinmaya rasa pratibhavita bhis dhabirya eva nijarupataya kalabhi goloka eva nivasatya kilatma bhuto govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami. I worship Govinda, the primeval lord, residing in his own realm, Goloka, with Radha resembling his own spiritual figure, the embodiment of ecstatic potency. possessed of the 64 artistic activities in the company of her confidants, Sakis, embodiments of the extension of her bodily form, permeated and vitalized by his ever blissful spiritual rasa. Rama Samhita, chapter 5, 37th verse. The word rasa means taste or mellow. We enjoy sweets or candy because of their taste. Everyone is trying to enjoy some taste, and we want to enjoy sex because there is some taste there. That is called adi taste. Material tastes are different because they are tasted and quickly finished. Material tastes last only a few minutes. You may take a piece of candy and taste it and say, "Oh, that is very nice." But you have to taste another in order to continue the enjoyment. Material taste is not unlimited, but real taste is without end. Spiritual taste cannot be forgotten. It goes on increasing. Anandam Budhi Vardhanam, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, this taste is always increasing. Spiritual taste is like the ocean in the sense that it is very great. The Pacific Ocean is always tossing, but it is not increasing. By God's order, the ocean does not extend beyond its limit, and if it extends, there is havoc. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that there is another ocean, an ocean of transcendental bliss, an ocean that is always increasing. Anandambudhi Vardhanam Pratipadam Purnamrita Swadhanam Sarvatma Snapanam Param Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankirtanam. By chanting Hare Krishna, our pleasure potency increases more and more. One who has realized Shri Krishna is always living in Vrindavan, Vaikuntha. Although a devotee may seem to be living in some place far from Vrindavan, he is always living in Vrindavan because he knows that Krishna is present everywhere, even within the atom. The Supreme Lord is bigger than the biggest and smaller than the smallest. Once we are fully realized and established in Krishna consciousness, we never lose sight of Krishna and our bliss is always increasing. This is a true yoga system, Bhakti Yoga, as expounded by Lord Shri Krishna himself in Bhagavad Gita.